All right, so let's do first like a small review of the master slides so that we get up to speed. So this still my kids, still as lovely as the last time. Okay, so first up the master equation, just to remind you about the notations. We have data xi, yi. X is my input, y is my output. And they come ID. I'm focusing on linear predictions parameterized by a vector theta in RD. So think of D as being potentially very large. And I'm trying to minimize a convex data fitting term. So convex because my loss is convex. And I may or may not add a regularizer. So in terms of losses, I think this figure you also saw from Steve Wright. Think least squares is one classical example when you do regression. But many problems in machine learning, you want to predict a binary random variable, and we replace the square loss in the turquoise here by the red, which is the hinge loss for the support vector machine, or logistic, which is the green one. So this is the main thing. So hinge is non-smooth. Okay, so I've spent like a lot of time the first lecture describing smooth problems. And what I will do now is go more into the smoothness, smooth problems. So this was not interesting. So key was this training cost. So there's clearly a mismatch between training cost and testing cost. This I have access to, but this I don't have access to, and I'm going to be judged by that. Okay, I really care about predicting well on testing data. Rather like predicting well on training data is not so important. Okay, so this is fine. This assumptions I'm over. Pop, 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 pop. This is fine. Puff, puff, puff. Okay, so I went. Let's get that one. So in the non-smooth case, okay, so the main algorithm was subgradient descent or gradient descent. So it does not always go up, go down, but typically it goes down, and you take a direction towards the negative gradient, and then you project. Okay, so this was the main algorithm. And the proof was essentially in three lines using like a bit of convex analysis. And if you combine this one with statistics, this is maybe one of the important slides. So if you combine, so you optimize the training risk up to some constraints, and the constraints were like a bound in L2 norm, then you know that the empirical risk F hat and the true risk do not deviate too much, and the order of deviation is 1 over root n. And when you optimize, after t steps, you do an error of 1 over root t. And we said, okay, if you take t equal to n, the number of iterations is the number of observations, then you don't lose, get the same order, but you get O of n squared d in terms of complexity. Okay, so n squared, when n is 1 billion, or if it's often more, this is not very good. And then, puff, puff, we looked at oh, I did not update. Let me update. Sorry, I updated on my laptop, but not here. Ah, sorry about that. Ah. Should be quick. Up. Et voilà. Okay, so not many differences, but so I'm still there. Okay. Up. Okay, so there was this. Yeah. So this was the. This was. essentially, I was there. Okay, so statistics 1/n, optimization 1/t, and then we decided to combine the two by doing like stochastic gradient descent. And the key, as a key equation there is the key slide is here. So now I'm going to minimize my testing error f. So f will be a function which I don't observe, but I only get unbiased estimates of the gradients. Okay, and f prime n is this unbiased estimate. And the key is that the expectation is correct, unbiasedness, but I don't need the variance to go to zero. And in the context of machine learning, this corresponds to a loss of a single data point. And so now the number of iterations is exactly equal to the number of observations. And we looked at stochastic gradient descent. And one slide which I didn't really look at yesterday, but I think it's quite important, so we'll go over it today, is what do we call online learning. So often, people tend to say online learning is stochastic gradient. Okay, so there is a difference. So what is the difference? What is stochastic approximation? Okay, this is the situation where you want to optimize an expectation. Okay, so here Z is my xi, this is my data. And this is what I want to estimate, to minimize, and only observe stochastic gradients. What is batch learning? Batch learning is a process where I'm going to get a finite set Z1 to Zn. Okay, this is a classical thing that most of the classical algorithms in machine learning are doing batch learning. I get data, I form the empirical risk, then I minimize the empirical risk. So what I've described earlier on was batch learning. Okay, I just assume my data are fixed and I minimize. So of course, I have to start to constrain my class of functions, otherwise I will overfit, and then I get bounds like I have described. So what is online learning? This is something which is a bit different, is that I'm going to observe the Z_i's one by one. And what I will do is that whenever I observe a new Z, I'm going to update my predictor and make a prediction. And then I pay a cost, which is the loss between my prediction and my observation. So what I'm being judged with is not the loss on the for the final estimate, but it's the cumulative loss throughout my predictions. And often, if you subtract the loss of a constant prediction, you get what is called a regret. And most people in online learning will start to study that regret, which is, in my setup, the excess risk. In my case, I tend to look at f of theta minus f of theta star, which is what should go to zero. The key difference, so when the Zn's are id, okay, this and that are almost equivalent. Okay, I get id data. And in fact, many of the algorithms for there, they come from there and vice versa. The thing becomes more interesting when you allow the Zn to be non-id, non-stochastic. They can be anything. So you may, nature or an oracle or whatever you want to call that, may choose a Z which is difficult and which may depend on the past. Okay, so this is a case where things are much more difficult. And everything that I say today does not apply to this like potentially adversarial setup. And there's a lot of work on that. And if you look at online learning, and there are nice papers by Cesar Bianchi and Bubeck on that topic. But today, I'm focusing mostly on ID observations. Okay. So online learning is close to what I do. But in online learning, you have the stochastic online learning, which is what I'm doing, essentially, and the potentially adversarial setup. OK, so this was the algorithm, stochastic gradient descent. So every time step, I go down the negative gradients. And the key question was, how should I choose the step size? OK, and then this was among the last slides, which I went over last time, is I can take the exact same algorithm as a non-stochastic case by just replacing the gradient by a stochastic gradient. And everything was going through in a very similar way. The proof was just the same. I just added expectations when I needed. So I get this 1/√n convergence. So here, the key is that I get convergence on the test set. Okay, so this is really really important. Then I mentioned this was the minimax, in the sense that you cannot find an algorithm that will do better than this on all of those problems. And this dates back for numerous KNUD. Get the proof. Then I mentioned quickly that if I assume strong convexity, I get a better rate, where you replace this 1 over root n by 1 over n mu. And then we can go to the new things. Okay, so what I've like summarized so far is the non-smooth situations where combining statistics and optimization does work pretty well, and you get this nice matching bounds. With a key concept was strong convexity, you get faster if you go strongly convex, problems get easier. So now we look over like the smooth case, which is closer to what has been done in the 50s, and hopefully we will get new insights. So as a summary, and this is the last summary I promise, this is the global rate which I have described. If you strongly convex 1 over nu, and if you just convex 1 over root n, those two were achieved by a stochastic gradient descent with averaging, but the step sizes are different. Okay, so if you have a hard problem, you should have somewhat bigger step sizes, and if you have an easy problem, you should have small step sizes. It is a bit counterintuitive. Okay, you would say that if it's easy, you have to be very conservative, and this is the opposite. If it is hard, I have to be conservative. But here, if it is hard, I know I'm not going to do very well, so I make big step size, and that's enough. So this, we lose adaptivity of the gradient. So if you remember yesterday, in the deterministic case for smooth functions, I described the convergence of gradient descent, and it was either as 1 over t or as an exponential of t. And this, with the exact same algorithm, with the exact same step size, was adaptive. So in the stochastic world, it's not adaptive. You have to choose which regime you want to be in. And of course, you almost never know mu in advance. Okay, so you're stuck with the fact that you know that there is a good step size, but you don't know which one to take. So this may look like, oh yeah, it's easy, you try several ones, but it's not as simple as it sounds, because if you have to try like ten step sizes, you go 10 times slower. Okay, so it's not totally obvious. Okay, so here, from that simple equation, there's you can do a lot of things which are beyond that simple equation. So I will mention a bit, if you add a norm which is non-smooth, okay, you can do, and I'm sure that several other talks have presented that already. And those are standard references of the field, so if you want to know more, you can look at them. Then, this was done mostly for signal processing from optimization. But there is something that is also well known from signal processing, which is so-called like polyacropot averaging, is the following. Is that if you assume smoothness, so now if you're willing to make a stronger assumption, what they showed, like Polyak-Andrzejewski and Rupert, is that if you do a step size which is in between those two, okay, so between very small and between very big, then you get robustness to strong convexity. You get this 1 over n. And so this may look like a small improvement, but between 1 over root n and 1 over n, it's much, much better. And from 1 over n mu to 1 over n, it's also much better because you lose the dependence on a condition number. Okay, so this is a good thing, but it's only asymptotic. Okay, this means that if I wait long enough, at the end, I will get to 1 over n. In particular, it does not say how fast you forget initial conditions. Okay, so whenever you optimize, so you start from a point and you want to reach a second point. Okay, so if a good bound will tell you, depending on where I start, I will be faster or slower. Of course, if I start from a solution, it should be fast. If I start far away, it should be slow. All of those bounds, for the moment, have essentially like not taken this into account. And the goal now for the next 20 minutes is to really look into this. Can I characterize the speed of those problems? There will always be two terms. the rate at which I forget initial conditions, and the noise in the problem. Okay, so this is the main thing for now. So this will be the main assumptions. Okay, so stochastic gradient descent, this you have seen, averaging. Now I'm going to assume that I have a smooth loss. So now I'm moving away from the supervector machine. This is going to be like least squares or logistic regression. Okay, so I will assume that all of my Fn are smooth, so smooth loss. And I will sometimes assume F is strongly convex, and sometimes I will not. So here, a small, this is like a, it should be an exercise. Is it possible to have Fn strongly convex? So I tell you what is Fn, I remember Fn. Fn is the loss between Yn and theta transpose phi of Xn. Okay, so is it possible to have Fn strongly convex? Anybody willing to, if I ask a question, to be yes or no. So what is Fn? Fn is a function, okay, so L is a loss which will be convex in the second argument, but that function depends only on a single projection, okay, of theta onto a vector. So this means that all variation, if theta varies orthogonally to phi of xn, you don't move, okay, so you are super flat. So the Hessian of that guy has rank one. Okay, so this one will never be invertible. So Fn will never be strongly convex. Okay, so this means that it's kind of useless to ask for Fn to be strongly convex. We only assume that the expected value of Fn is strongly convex. Okay, so just minor thing, but it's good to set up the intuition about strong convexity. Okay, so now we present like work from a few years ago with Eric Moulin from Telecom. Well, essentially, we took we did it the hard way. So since nobody knew how you should choose gamma n, which we did all possible cases. Okay, so this is like a long paper, and the goal is to get insights on the behavior, and at the end, the results are somewhat simple. So what was clear from before, and what from before, this is from Robbins Monroe, was the classical step size was 1 over n. Okay, this is what you would have learned from classes in the 80s or 70s or even like 10 years ago. People were advocating 1 over n. Okay, so this was the classical step size. And this, what we will show is that this is not robust to ill conditioning. So what is ill conditioning? This is if you're just convex, if you have some flat part, this will be slow. So what we advocate is, and this is simply a way of transforming what Polyak and Yudisky had done to the non-asymptotic regime. So what do I mean by to be non-asymptotic? I mean to have a bound which is true for all n, and not only asymptotically. So let's look at the results. So they may look, of course, they look a bit more complicated, but you always have two parts. The blue part is the rate at which you forget initial conditions. Okay, so theta zero is your starting point. Theta star is your final point. So the, in blue, over the rate at which you forget. In blue, the rate at which you forget. In red, this is the influence of the noise. Okay, so what do I mean by noise? Is that sigma squared is the noise in my gradients. So I get noisy gradients. So they have quite expectation, but they have some variance. And sigma square is that variance. Okay, so let's analyze a bit those results. So this is before averaging and after averaging. So before averaging, what you obtain is that if gamma n goes to zero slowly enough, you're going to forget this exponentially fast. This is good. You like that, okay? You like to, wherever I start from, I will not be impacted by my initial conditions. But the price to pay is that then you get this term for the noise, is that this will be proportional to your step size.
So this means that if I do a large step size to forget initial conditions quickly, I get a large noise at the end. Okay, so and then I will show examples on how this behaves.
So this is before averaging.
And if you look
carefully, when gamma n is proportional to 1 over n, this will not tend to 0. So of course, this is just a bound, okay? But you can derive like similar lower bounds for the problem. Now, if you use averaging, you're going to, of course, improve one and degrade the other. Okay, so first, when you do averaging, before looking at the formula, there is something which is always true. So if theta n tends to theta star, it's always true that the mean, okay, also converges to theta star, okay? So Cesaro mean theorem. But the problem is that once you do this, so here, what you gained when you do averaging, so if theta n was moving a lot, theta bar will tend to be a bit smoother, okay? So you gain in terms of noise, but the problem is that you will lose a lot. So why would you lose a lot? If this goes to theta star exponentially fast, the average will not go exponentially fast anymore. Okay, so now if you have, let's say if you have no noise, if theta n, okay, if theta n goes, if you plot, let's say theta n minus theta star in 1D, if this goes like very quickly, exponentially fast as n, the average will be much slower. Why? Because you will average this, so the series will be convergent, and you divide by n. So at the end, the speed is at most 1 over n. Okay, so as soon as you do averaging, you transform what was exponential into something which is just 1 over n. Okay, so you lose, you will lose a lot. Okay, and this is not surprising, and that in that setup, we recover something that goes down to zero as 1 over n squared. Okay, because if this goes to that as 1 over n, then the square goes to zero as 1 over n squared. So this is what we obtain, and the key that in terms of noise we get independence on the independence from the step size. So this is something which is really important in practice. What does it say? It says that however I choose my step size, I get the same term over there. Okay, so this was essentially what Polyak and Judisky were deriving, and they covered the exact same thing. So let's look at plots. Okay, so the proof. So I will simply go over the first line. Okay, so the proof, it's so don't just look at the first line, it's always the same thing. Okay, I have my algorithm, okay, I take my distance to optimum. I develop it, and I use properties of my problem, and then boom, okay? So it takes a while, but it's not the goal of today. Unless you really want to, I don't want to, because it's, but just the idea is always, so the funny part about that topic is that the tools are basic, okay? Simply expectations and conditioning, but the computations are tricky. And this will come back tomorrow as well, where when you see this, okay, as a PhD student, you might say, ah, if only I could have a machine do it for me, it would be much easier. So tomorrow, what I'll do is have a machine do it for me. Okay, so this is like advertisement for tomorrow. Since I'm lazy, I found a machine to do it in my place. Okay, so a bit of plots. Okay, so I do believe this is important to have some ideas of how this behaves. So I took very big data, d equals 1. Okay, so let's take the dumbest problem. I want to minimize the square of theta, and I take a gradient, which is theta, and I add some noise. Okay, just give you some intuition about the problem. Now, on the left, I've used like a step size as 1 over root n, and on the right, a step size as 1 over n. Okay, so then the three colors, depending on the constant I put in front of my 1 over n, or 1 over root n, so 1, 5, and 1 over 5. Same thing for alpha equals 1. And then in dotted, this is averaging. and in plane this is without averaging. So all of my plots today and tomorrow will always be the same. I will always show the number of iterations in the x-axis in logarithmic scale, and on the y-axis this will always be the distance to optimum in logarithmic scale. Okay, this is a standard way of showing the results in that setup. So here I can do it because I know f star. Okay, of course in practice you don't know f star, so you need a way to estimate it, but here we know f star, so if you do well you should go down like this. Okay, so how should we start? Let's start with a standard setup, 1 over n. Okay, so what you get is, so if the constant C is large enough, then you get a nice line like this, and this is a line of slope minus 1 if you look carefully. Minus 1. But as soon as you get a step size which is a bit too small, okay, what's happening is that the slope will tend to be flatter. So you come at an array which is slower. And in fact, if C gets even smaller, it will always converge, but arbitrarily slowly. Okay, so if C is too small, so you make really, really small steps, you converge very slowly. But now you say, oh, but that's okay, let's take C very big. If you take C very big, so C equals 5, you start by diverging. Okay, not very nice as well. Okay, so how would you trust a method that will start by diverging before converging? Okay, so this is illustrating on a very simple problem that the constant C has to be chosen correctly, because between the C that starts to diverge and the C that is slow, there's a factor of 25. So it's not a big difference in 1D. So if you go to a much higher dimension, this difference might be much stronger. So here, the effect of averaging is a bit limited. Typically, averaging does work a bit better or not, so it doesn't make a big difference. Now let's look at this like bigger step size. Okay, so alpha being 1/2, you make a bigger step. So now the problem gets a bit more interesting. So before averaging, okay, this is a plane curves, then you will converge at a rate which would be gamma n. So from on the last slide, I had a convergence rate of gamma n. So this meant what? This meant that if gamma n is minus 1/2, I should get a slope of minus 1/2. So you can check that slope is minus 1/2. So if I don't do averaging, then I will converge like that. So this is the regime with which I go. This is the final asymptotic rate. And what's happening at the beginning? So at the beginning, this is where initial conditions will start to be important. So if I take a step size which is too big, even worse than with the step size of 1 over n there, I start to diverge, so it's bad. If I take C equals 1, then I tend to lose initial conditions very quickly. So this is a black curve. And this is good. I forget things very quickly. If now I take C being 1 over 5, it's a bit slower. Okay, so here I like what's happening there, but I don't like what's happening there. When you do, because here I forget conditions quickly, but I get hit by the noise. Now if you do averaging, the cool thing is those curves will tend to be always the same, the same slope. So you improve on the final convergence, but you don't degrade too much the start of the algorithm. Okay, this is to illustrate the gains of using averaging. Okay, so why do I state robustness to rank constants is that if you use a big step size, so 1 here is somewhat the best one. But let's say I use 1 over 5, so it's not as good as 1, but it's not terrible. Whereas if I take this decaying step size, if I miss it by a factor of 5, it can go from decent to very bad. Okay, just to illustrate the fact that finding this C is not an easy business. So if you want to know more for bigger simulations on that setup, there's a nice website by Léon Botou. So what is typically done in practice is to try several values of C, run for a while, take the best one on test error, after a while, and then run on the entire data with the best value of C. Okay, so this is a classical heuristic
which works somewhat well in practice. Okay, so this was for the strongly convex problems. Now let's look at the regular convex problem. Sorry, I won't go over the details so much of the results. And so what was known from before is that a step size of 1 over root n will get this 1 over root n behavior from before. This was known in the non-smooth case as well. And let's see how it works on my simple problems. But now, so I took, and this is like, this was a question from Steve Wright. Okay, find me a non-strongly convex or non-strictly convex function. So the power 4 was one of these examples. So I've taken, like, on the right, the power 2. Okay, on the left, power 2. On the right, power 4. So here, power 4 is not smooth. So why is power 4 non-smooth? Typically, because at infinity, the Hessian is square, theta square, and goes to infinity. So what I did is, I take power 4 there, and then at minus 1, 1, I do interpolation, linear, or maybe quadratic interpolation, to make the function like twice differentiable. Okay, so this is one way of making sure that my assumptions are valid. Again, very small data, dimension 1, but to me, you get the insights are already there. Oh, affine, not square. Okay, so how should we read this? So again, like in several values, so here I compare several powers of n. Remember, the step size is gamma n is a constant over n to the power alpha, and those are the alphas, 1/3, 1/2, 2/3, 1. And the goal is to see which values of alpha are robust to the lack of strong convexity. So if you assume if the problem is locally strongly convex, f of theta, then the minimum is 0, of course. Then all step sizes after averaging tend to be correct. So before averaging, this is here, is the convergence rate is gamma n. Okay, so the longer the step size, the worse the performance. And this is what's happening. This is a bigger step size, 1/3, then 1/2, then 2/3, and all the rest are good. And as soon as I do averaging, boom, I get something which is like a previous slide. Now if I take power 4, okay? Now if I take power 4, what you can see is that if you take this 1 over n step size, yeah, so the worst step size, okay, so it still does converge, but the worst step size is the green, after averaging, is the green step size, which is 1 over n. So it's a case where the lack of strong convexity, the worst you can do is 1 over n, and this is even stronger in higher dimensions. Okay, so remember, it's just the green. After averaging, this is the worst one. Whereas, if you take a bigger step size, then you go much, much faster after you diverge. So here, this is one example showing that strong convexity, even in 1D, makes a difference. Any questions on those one-dimensional plots? So I have like bigger plots tomorrow or later today. Okay, so just to give you insights. Okay, so now L1 norms. So I guess some people care about the L1 norms. I do care about the L1 norm and other norms. So what does it mean? So it means that I have my function f of theta, which is my testing risk, and I add a function omega. It can be the L1 norm, it can be the TV norm, it can be whatever norm you like. This can even be not a norm. It has to be convex only. And so as you may expect, and I think you have seen this at least once or twice, is that you replace this gradient step, okay, by a proximal step on top of the gradient. Okay, so this is very classical in the BAT setting, where you have a real gradient. You can do the same with stochastic gradient and replace stochastic gradient descent, which is this, by simply a proximal step on top of it. Okay, it's the exact same thing. You have to be a bit careful. Sometimes you need to add. You need to be careful on the constant that you add on top of it. So there's some subtleties, but the principle is just the same. Okay. So there's a nice paper by Chao and Hu et al. That have been doing this. Something which I won't talk so much about, like in these lectures, is alternative frameworks. So here, what I lack in what I present is the relationship with gradient. Okay, I have gradient, I have stochastic gradient. So this is rather old methods from the 50s, but to me the relationship is clear. There are other setups, in particular by Nesterov, called dual averaging and mirror descent by Nimirovsky and colleagues, which are very similar, okay, which have some added benefits, but for which you lose the connection with gradient descent a bit. So if you really want to know more, there is a nice papers by those people. But I just put it there so that you realize that when you see this, it's just a different way of presenting stochastic gradient descent. Overall, it's the same thing. Okay, you do a small random step, but the specifics are a bit different. Okay, so now this was for the smooth case. Any questions so far? No? Yep. Excuse me? Sure. You seem to need a break, okay? So let's have a break. Like a 2-minute break. Very good. So what was the take-home message from the previous slides was in the smooth case, okay, you can get away with a step size of 1/√n, and you can adapt to both strong convexity and non-strong convexity. Okay, so this was the one way of saying that 1/n was old school, okay. 1/√n is more like recent school, and what I will do now is look at the new school, which is constant. Okay, so alpha being equal to 0, and hopefully this should still work. But before doing this, we'd like to mention a word about adaptivity. Okay, so this is very important in practice. Why do you want to be adaptive? So adaptive to what? To strong convexity. So if locally, so typically you have functions, let's say logistic, so where you have some flat parts and you have some non-flat parts, like that. So if you have a function like this, you know that mu is 0. Because globally, you're not globally strongly convex. So this means that if you want to rely on a method which is adapted to strong convexity, you're going to take mu equal to 0, you won't be able to do it. Okay? So what you would really like is something that will say, oh, far away, okay, I'm just convex, so I want to converge at height 1/√n. But as I get closer to the global optimum, if I'm lucky enough, then around this, you may get some mu which is non-zero locally, and then you want to go faster at the end. Okay, so this is something which is really important and true for gradient descent. In the deterministic setup, it will be slow at the beginning, and at the end, trying to catch some directions of strong convexity to get faster. Okay, so adaptivity is, and I think it's very important because this is why it works so well in practice. Okay, if gradient descent didn't have like any adaptivity to strong convexity, I think I would be out of a job because everything would be so slow. Okay, so it's not always recognized as such, adaptivity, but I do believe this is really important. So is it possible to get adaptivity for gradient descent, but for the stochastic gradient descent? Okay, so what do you mean to be adaptive? I mean to be having a single algorithm that we do as well as those two, and if possible, with mu being not the global strong convexity constant, but the local strong convexity constant. Okay, so the goal of adaptivity is exactly this. You want to do the best of the two worlds, but of course with a single algorithm. So of course, since those like minimax rates of convergence were essentially like a minimax, they will need some extra assumption, and this is what I'm going to show. Now, so let's look at logistic regression. Okay, so this is the same setup as before. I have like features in RD. Yn is a minus 1, 1. This is a loss for a single observation. Okay, this is fine. I care about the expected error. And the key difficulty in logistic is this is what I plotted that, is that it will never be strongly convex. Okay, I've already mentioned it, is that because of the flat parts in the asymptotes, you are not strongly convex, but you may be locally strongly convex. Okay, locally, you get some form of strong convexity. So how is it typically done in practice? You say, okay, so this is like flat far away, so let's put a bound on the predictions. Let's put a bound of M, and then on that interval, the loss is strongly convex, so I'm getting picky because locally, it will be strongly convex. If you do this, what you get as constants, you get very bad constants. So why? So let's do a bit of derivatives. Let's do that here. So if you call phi, phi of t is log of 1 plus exponential minus t. Okay, so phi prime, the derivative, so trust me, is 1 over 1 plus exponential t. Okay, and the second order derivative should be 1 over 1 plus exponential t, 1 over 1 plus exponential minus t. Okay, and trust me, okay. So what does this mean? It means that if you threshold at t, okay, you get some exponential terms. Okay, if you go to minus m or m, you get terms of order exponential m. Okay, so this is bad. Why? Because in all of my bounds, I get 1 over mu. Okay, so if mu is exponential minus m, 1 minus mu is exponential m, and this means that you have a bound which is correct, but very pessimistic. The goal of now is to show that for logistic you can do better. Okay, and why do I present this? Because it will use some tools which may be of interest to some of you, independently of optimization. Okay, so this is the logistic loss. So what? How are we going to do it? So I'm going to call mu now the lower second value of the Hessian at the optimum. Okay, so this is what I call the local strong convexity. So what, this is the result, okay, so this is not, this is essentially what I've described in the slide before, and what is interesting in the next slide, so the distance to optimum, okay, theta star is my optimal value, theta bar n is my average error rate, and f is my test error, expectation again because my data are assumed to be random, and goes down to zero, as a minimum of 1 over root n, and this 1 over n mu. This is what, this was what I wanted to do. But the interesting aspect is, what did I use about logistic, which is special? What I used is self-accordance. So who knows about self-accordance? No? A bit? Okay, so this is something which is very useful in optimization. And how is it defined? So a function which is convex is said self-accordant if it is three times differentiable, and the third order derivative is bounded from above by a power of the second order derivative. So why the power three halves? Just to be affine invariant. Okay, so if you want to be affine invariant, if you replace t by 2t, then the power three, because there are two derivatives, should be balanced with the power of 3 half. Okay, so this is a classical notion of self-accordance. And this is for one-dimensional, like univariate functions. And you can extend the definition to all like functions in RD by looking at functions defined on a one-dimensional line. So this was introduced by Nesterov and Nemirovsky. And what I like about this is that with that notion, you can like do very simple proofs with almost no constants. So if you take Newton algorithm, it's an algorithm to minimize functions based on linear systems. So if you want to get the proof of quadratic convergence, this will require a lot of constants. You need like derivatives of second order to be bounded from below, from above. You need also derivatives, like third order derivatives. With the simple assumptions of self-accordance, you get no you get no constants. It's very, very sharp. Okay, so I really encourage you to read the very nice book by Boyd. So the convex optimization book, maybe I should. So Boyd and Vandenberg. So it's free online. Where there's a very nice chapter on self-concordance. Okay, so really, it's really, really neat. So in my context, okay, the machine learning setup. So classical examples of functions which are self-concordant, you have exponential logarithm, and so on. Because the classical functions are self-concordant. Is this one self-concordant? So the logistic, unfortunately, okay, I can go on one more time. So the third order derivative is equal to the second order derivative times it's 1 minus 2. Okay, trust me on this one. So it is sad, but I've been using that so much that I know it by heart. So sad, but that's okay. So what you have is that it is not true that you get like the third order is less than the second order power 3/2. What you only get is that this is less than 1 absolute value. So you only get like a different version of self-concordance. Okay. So essentially, whatever you could do with that, you can redo without the power. So everything goes through, essentially. So why is it interesting and how is it useful? Is that you can do global Taylor expansions. Okay. So which you cannot do otherwise. And you can relate like expansions of derivatives of different orders. So this is really, really, so it may look a bit abstract, but when you need this, it's very handy. And this has come up in several places. They say if you do L1, if you do like logistic plus L1, this is a good way of analyzing logistic plus L1. If you, otherwise, you're going to get like bad constants. Okay. I just mentioned it because it's really like something which is very specific about logistic, which you can use to do proofs and to get better results. And this will come up as well tomorrow. It's really a nice assumption. Proof sketch, not good for it. Okay, so this was the adaptivity. So this was the first step. I said gradient was adaptive in the deterministic case. Let's make stochastic gradient adaptive in the stochastic case. So here, notice that I'm not creating a new algorithm. I'm simply saying, let's get a better analysis for something that is already existing. But let's be a bit more greedy. Can I remove the n? Okay, I like to remove the n. The mu, not the mu. I like to remove the mu. I would like to be totally robust to any conditioning. Okay, is it possible to be totally robust? And of course, if I have removed the mu, the 1 over root n is kind of useless. Okay, I always do better. Okay, so this is a goal for the last 30 minutes, is to show that I can indeed remove the mu, but I will need to make an extra more assumption. Okay, so what I did yesterday, I started from non-smooth, and I'm reputing more assumptions as we go along. Now I've put like smoothness. Now I've put self-concordance. And now we'll go even one step further to make the problem even more simpler, which is least squares. Okay, so if you take least squares. So now for the rest of today, let's go around for least squares. So this is the least square loss, okay, the expected value of my square difference. So in that context, stochastic gradient descent is often called least mean square, LMS. And typically it has been studied since like the 50s or 60s, typically without averaging and with decreasing step size. Okay, typically 1 over n is the usual thing, and often with a strong convexity assumption. So what we proposed with my colleague Eric Molin again is to take a constant step size. Okay, so this, in the next slide, we show why it can work. So if you forget about a decaying step size, not 1 over n, not 1 over root n, but constant, then what we were able to show, and this will appear clearer the next slide, is that same type of quantity, this theta star is my optimal value, my optimal predictor, F is still my test error. Theta bar N is my iterate average. Expectation because my data are random. And this goes down to zero as 1 over N. Okay, so there's still a term that depends on the noise in my problem. Okay, and a term that depends on initial condition, on initial conditions. So the key here is the fact that we were able to remove the mu. There's no mu anymore. Okay, so for the experts, that sigma squared d over n cannot be improved. Okay, so this is the usual variance of least squares. It's always sigma squared p over n. And for those that do compress sensing, they often get a sigma squared k over n times log d. Okay, and the log d is what you get on top of the best possible bound, but they get the sigma squared k over n. This is the exact same thing. But here, k in their case is a sparsity index. But here, this is just since there's no sparsity, you get sigma squared d. So the 4 is not optimal, but the sigma squared d over n cannot be improved. Okay, so this is one thing. Why is this, in fact, totally trivial, or almost totally trivial? Let's look at the proof later. Let's look at the recursion. Okay, so this is the loss for a single observation. Okay, so this is simple. This is my recursion. So this is a gradient of that. Okay, standard differentiation. And as all stochastic approximation methods, my iterates theta n, they form a Markov chain. Why? Because the past is only only summarized into theta n minus 1, and my data are ID. Okay, because the data are independent, I get a Markov chain for my iterates. But since my step size is constant, this Markov chain is homogeneous. Okay, if gamma would depend on n, my dynamics will change at every iteration, but now gamma is constant. So I get a homogeneous Markov chain, and as most homogeneous Markov chain, they tend to converge to a stationary distribution, which I call pi of gamma, and expectations theta bar of gamma. So that algorithm does not converge. I start from theta zero, and then I move, and then I end up oscillating around the expectation under my stationary distribution, but I will never converge. Okay, this will always oscillate. The key is that for least squares, because the gradient is a linear function, the expectation under the stationary is my best estimator, best estimate theta star. So this means that my iterates, they will go quickly around theta star. Okay, and then when you do averaging, you will end up converging quickly to the expectation under the stationary distribution. Okay, this is often called the ergodic theorems. Ergodic theorem, even better, you know the rate of convergence. It is known that if you average a function along the iterates of a Markov chain, it does convert to the expectation under the stationary at rate 1 over root n. Okay? And since we are measuring performance with square distances, we get that, a square of 1 over root n is 1 over n. So by design, that algorithm has to converge at rate 1 over n. Okay? So this is the 1 over n part has to be there. The difficulty is to get the constants correct. Okay? So to get this and this, this is not the easy part. This is not easy. But this is the fact that you get 1 over n. It's almost there by design because you get this Markov chain that is oscillating and then you converge. In terms of proof, okay, this is in fact the proof is semi-simple in the sense that you first, like I did yesterday, to prove convergence of gradient descent for least squares, what I did is I wrote down the recursion, removed theta star. Okay, and then I obtained something which was very close, where this was H, and I had no noise. Okay, yesterday I had exactly the exact same recursion where this was H, my Hessian, and no noise. So here, since I have stochasticity, this means that my H is only observed through the dot product of Xn or phi of Xn with itself, plus I get some noise. Okay, so the technique, the proof technique, is somewhat simple in the sense that we're going to replace this complex recursion by a simpler recursion where I remove what is annoying. So what is annoying when you do like dynamical systems with randomness is like randomness is a matrix. Okay, this is the annoying part, so we remove it. Okay, replace this by its expectation. And now I'm back into something which is very simple, which is a constant matrix. So I get a linear dynamical system with added noise. Okay, so this is a familiar land. So in the context of discrete, like dynamical system, it's easy. I can simply get directly the full expression of that, and I can compute directly everything just based on replacing this by that. Okay, if you do this, after two lines of computation, you get to what I've shown. But of course, the final difficult aspect is to show that you can get away with it. That can you really replace this by that? And this is where things get difficult. And I don't really want to go into it. But on principle, this is really you looking at what's happening for the simple dynamical system with added noise. Okay, let's look at like a bit bigger simulations, dimension 20. So we're getting slowly to big data. Okay, so here again, in the x-axis, n in logarithmic scale, distance to optimum in the y-axis. So here I've compared several step sizes, decaying step size. Okay, so 1/√n, because this is supposed to be the correct, the best one, and different values of constants. In dotted, this is before averaging, and in plain, this is after averaging. So what you observe is that before averaging, you don't converge. You tend to oscillate, but there's no convergence. As you get a smaller step size, you get a bit closer, okay, but it doesn't converge. Whereas if you start to do averaging, all the curves go down and following, they all follow the slope 1/n. Okay, just to illustrate the result that before averaging, you don't get convergence. After, you do get convergence. For the decaying step size, it was going as 1/√n. Okay, before averaging, and 1/n after. Okay, this was expected from what I explained before the break. This was for p equals 20. Let's look at bigger data. Okay, so what we often do in machine learning is we have some benchmarks, okay, and which are somewhat big, sometimes not big. So those on the left, I got the alpha benchmark. I forget what it was, but with n is quite big and p is quite small. And news is like prediction of news. What are the news? I think it's to predict if the news is about like finance or sports or something like that. It's a prediction on text. So what is typical on the prediction on text is that the way you encode your data is through a big sparse vector. Okay. So here, I have 1 million dimensions, but many of them are equal to zero. So this comes back to a question that you had like 2 days ago. So we have sparsity. Okay, so we can use sparsity. So why can we use sparsity? Because the updates, if you look at the update is my iterates, and I subtract a real number times my features. So if my features are sparse, this update is sparse. So the complexity is O of S, where S is the number of non-zeros. And this is true for all stochastic gradients. It is well adapted to sparsity in the features. Okay, so on the top, the alpha. On the bottom, the news dataset. So why is there two columns? There are two columns because there are the fake column and the true column. So on the left, okay, on the left, this is I'm taking algorithms with their official step size. Okay, in most optimization papers, often you have the step size for the bound to make the bound work, and then for the simulations. You often use a different step size, okay? So typically a much bigger step size. Why do you do this? Because typically bounds are very conservative, so it will only work if the step size is very small. Okay, so this is on the left. This is where I take the official step size, the one from the bound, that takes the paper, okay? So, and I take the step size, and I say that this is one. On the right, I do the standard technique of trying several step sizes and take the one that works best after a first pass over the data. Okay, So here, why cannot I go to minus infinity? The reason is this is real data. So I don't know F star. So here what I've done, which is standard machine learning, I split my data in train and test. Okay, the test is here to get the best theta star, and I compare the performance on train versus the performance on test. Since I don't get infinite data, when I reach the end of my training data, I recycle and do several passes. Okay, so here the black line, the black dotted line, is a full pass over the data, and after the black line, I'm doing several passes. Okay, so this is normal that after like the first pass, I tend to not improve too much. I still improve a bit. Okay, so doing several passes is better. I will come back to that on Friday. But that's why I don't go to minus infinity, because I end up saturating my performance because I don't have like infinite amounts of data. Okay, so this is true for the two setups. Okay, so on the left, this is like official step size. On the right, this is the optimized step size. So first, if you look at the performance, so I forget about the red curve, but between the green, which is 1 over root n, and this and blue, which is constant, you go much faster with a constant step size. And if you have a decaying step size, it goes very slowly. Okay, understand that it takes a long while before converging. Remember, this is like a logarithmic scale. Okay, so this here is 1,000 times slower than that. Okay. Now, if you start to optimize the step size, okay, so for the constant step size, if you optimize the constant in front of the step size, doesn't move too much. The exact same thing. So this shows that this constant step size is robust to the setup of the problem. I don't need to tweak it too much. You can always do better by adapting it, but it's already big enough. Whereas for the decaying step size, okay, to make it correct at that point, I have to take C so big that I start to diverge. Okay, same thing as before. When the decay of the step size is too rapid, you have to take the constant in front, which is very large. So you start by diverging. This is like a logarithmic scale. Okay, so the error is multiplied by 10. Before I do better. It's just a hint at the fact that decaying step size for that problem is not adapted. This was for alpha, and this is true for news, and this is common to many optimization algorithms. What you get from the bound is not what you get for the algorithm. Okay. So this is one way of getting robustness here. And last thing, this will be a question for tomorrow, is will it work for billion least squares? Okay, so can I, because, okay, where the money is not on least squares. Okay, so Google is rich, Facebook is rich, not because of least squares, because of logistic. Okay, so if you go logistic, this will go over tomorrow, but logistic, ah. Okay, can you go logistic? Okay, so let's try logistic. So exact same thing, I have a Markov chain, which is homogeneous, but the problem, and so it does converge to a stationary distribution, but the problem now is that the gradient of logistic is not a linear function. So I cannot invert expectation and differentiation. So the gradient at the average of my under my stationary is not zero. So this means that all my setup, I will oscillate around some value, which is not the correct one. So I will converge quickly to something which is not the correct one. Okay, so this kind of this was observed from before. And in terms of simulations, exact same simulations. Before averaging, I don't converge. After averaging, I do better, but I don't converge. Okay. So tomorrow I'll explain how you can restore all of this and get pop something like that, where this was before, after. So this will be for tomorrow, a way to get the benefits of constant step size, but without like the problems. Okay. Thank you, and see you on Friday.